Anybody bored?
No.
Anybody feel like I'm wasting their time? Is this all shit you already know?
No.
Okay, great. All right. I mean, seriously, it's okay to tell me to shut up. Like, if there's something, or a better thing is there something I'm missing in this dialogue so far, other than, for example, Tor, or about some counter-surveillance stuff? Like, I'm going to talk more about Tor. I'm going to talk about Rise Up. I'm going to talk about anti-forensics, social network mapping, text messaging, cameras, chatting, that kind of stuff. Like, I mean,
specific stuff.
What you mentioned before.
Okay.
You mentioned like freedom of information requests. You find some evidence that gives you justification for asking. But one of the things I'm seeing happen more and more is you've seen the posted online, and they've redacted 80% of it. So that it almost they beat us at that. You know, it's almost you get the thing and there's no information in it. That and is it all you see time when they say not disclosing your password is illegal. You have to give it to us.
I know of situations where the U.S. government has threatened people for not disclosing their passphrase. So one of my favorite tricks is that, like, when they have taken my computer, for example, which they took my computer at the border in the summer of 2010, the U.S. Army, Immigration Customs Enforcement, Customs and Border Protection, like, they basically all got together, had a little powwow, and they took my computer. They asked me for the passphrase to my computer, and I said, that's crazy. What passphrase? I don't have a hard drive. And they were like totally baffled. And I had a sort of, you know, hilarious moment where I said, well, one day when you too learn how to use technology, you'll be able to do cool tricks like not use a hard drive. They didn't like that, but they also didn't like it when I told them to fuck themselves. So it's you know, I mean, the best thing for not getting into that situation is to not get into that specific situation. If you know they're gonna take your data, you know, pull the drive from your computer, and then when they take your computer, sue them for destruction of your property. If they take your computer, you can never trust it. It's safe again. And you can say, I believe it has been tampered with, because reasonably, if they've turned it on, that's tampering, in my opinion. I didn't consent to that. Maybe
the hard drive ahead, how do you handle that?
I mean, literally, don't use a hard drive, right? If you have a bootable USB disk running Tails, which you can download from anywhere on the internet, you plug that into a computer that has no hard drive. You have another USB stick, you know, you're in great shape. Like, so for example, I had a little USB stick on me, which I was gonna show you, which is pretty neat, because it's like so small that you can put it inside of an earring or a nickel or whatever, right? And it's like you have an encrypted partition there, but it's also small enough you can smash it in your fingers, right? So there are techniques that you can do like that, which are like pretty extreme, but when you're talking about crossing the US borders, they meet you at the jetway. They maybe handcuff you or do worse stuff to you. I mean, I would prefer to be a little on the extreme side until they stop being so extreme. And so not having a hard drive is great, because you avoid the what's your passphrase question. And I think there's great value in that. And also, it is incredibly funny to see the look on their face when they think that they've got you. And really what they have is not a clue. It's really great. I can't tell you how satisfying that is, right? Like, it's so rare that you get that satisfaction when dealing with the surveillance state. But when you have that, you should relish that moment, because it is, man, fucking tastic.
So, right,
so here's how you not have a hard drive. There's an operating system. It's a bootable operating system. So when you turn your computer on, it uses an operating system to, like, power the computer. It's how you connect to the internet and all that stuff. I'm glossing over a lot of stuff. You can download a thing that's called Tails, which is the basically bootable operating system, and you put it onto a USB stick. You plug that into your computer. And when your computer turns on, it says, would you like to boot? Maybe it doesn't say, would you like to? Maybe there's some sequence of keys which you'll have to learn. It's basically a rain dance. You have to figure out what the rain dance is for your computer, and then maybe it rains. And maybe it won't work, right? I mean, this is like hacking at its finest. It like might not work at all. But in a lot of cases, you can get like a $200 laptop, you know, like a little, I call them drop tops, as in like, you just toss them if you need to. You don't have any emotional attachment to it, right? Materialism is a problem in a lot of ways, and like especially when it comes to electronics, right? So $50 USB stick or $2 USB stick and a $200 computer, you put them together and you boot up, and that's it, you're done. And there's a hard drive in it, you can unscrew it with a screwdriver, pull the hard drive out. You never use the hard drive. And in that case, you know, it's like if they get your USB stick, they get the operating system, but it doesn't save anything to the booting one. You have to have a different USB stick to save data. In fact, that's a feature we haven't implemented yet. So you can't easily save data. Well, that's great. It's like anti-forensics on accident. Well, I mean, Tails is designed to do counter-forensics or anti-forensics. But so in that case, you don't need to know very much except how to create that USB stick. So partner, who here is like a tech ops person? Raise your hand. Well, one of you guys commit to helping to make a Tails USB stick with her? Someone? Yeah, you will? I bet you can, but yeah. if you pair up, it's great because then you do it. It's not, I mean, I totally believe you can do it. There's no question. I think, however, it is actually a giant pain in the ass. Like when I need to do it, I'm like, oh gosh, okay, I'll find the thing and I do this stuff and like, and so on. We could make it a lot easier.
Is there a website?
If someone said that, they needed us to make it easier. Yeah?
Is there a website that people can use as like a jumping off point to learn more about these different technologies, encryption, spyware, phones, and stuff like that? Or do you have a web page that would have start people off
So there's not a really good single web page, except the Electronic Frontier Foundation has a thing, it's called Surveillance Self-Defense. And they try to make a manual where you just like start at the beginning and you move through the legal theory like we've done, and then you move into technical solutions. I think that's very valuable. I also think, for example, torproject.org, which is my employer, so I'm obviously biased here, but like I think what we are working on is making all this possible for other people without having to have a huge education. We're trying to build this, but we do it by giving away all the source code and all the specifications, so you can find someone to buddy up with to determine if the tech stuff is legit or not. And you shouldn't trust us. You should trust us and then verify if you want to, right? And that's what all this stuff we release is about. So in that case, that's how you would do, I think, that's how you do it. That's how I do it. So like when I travel to, say, visit a friend in another country, I usually take a laptop, which is like not free, but $200 is better than the time they took my most expensive computer ever. And that, you know, was my work laptop, and you know, that's like a pretty serious punishment. So that $200 laptop and a little $5 USB stick, if they take all of that, they get nothing at all. But there is no hard drive, and the USB stick that I'm booting from is the same one I downloaded it from the internet. I didn't change it at all. I had no configuration. It just all works automatically. And that, you can do that. No hard drive. And it's like a superhero trick, right? So, yeah?
Yeah, I mean that you need one to boot up, one stick to boot up and another one to save data on, is that?
Yeah.
You need them both together to get data.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. I mean, you could probably do it on one USB stick if you wanted to, but just for simplicity's sake, it's like, this is the one I eat, this is the one I don't care about, you know?
Just one more maintenance question. So, I already have a computer that, you know, is actually refurbished here. Mm-hmm. Is there any way to completely clean my hard drive and then remove it, and
that
I don't have to buy another $200 computer.
Yeah.
Is that possible?
Yeah, totally. So there's a disk. It's called DBAN, DBAN, I believe, and it's a you know, secure erase utility. So it's like for companies, you boot up and it like destroys all the data on all the drives so that they can securely throw the drives away. Well, that works both ways. So you can use that as well, and it's the same process. You put it on a USB stick or you burn it to a CD. And you know, you don't need to pull the hard drive from your computer. You can just install Ubuntu on that computer and add the, when you install it, please encrypt my hard drive option. And you're doing great. And if you have a refurbished computer and you're running Windows, for example, that's like leveling up to a degree where it's probably, but like if you're running like old Windows 98 or Windows XP or something that's abandoned by Microsoft, especially switching to something like Ubuntu has like a lot of options, and also people in this community especially really tried to support it. So like RiseUp, for example, really supports Linux and the free software alternatives. There's value in that. I mean, everybody has to decide their level of comfort. Like if you're gonna do a banner hang, the people that are afraid of heights usually don't go over the side. It's totally cool to not go over the side. You don't have to go over the side technically either. And so I would just recommend baby steps to become comfortable with it, because it's like a lifetime. It's a learning curve of a lifetime, I think. Do you have a question?
Incredible presentation. Thanks so much. Questions on two subjects. First, obviously, if there's a keylogger on your PC, Tor and TrueCrypt don't do you much good. But booting from one of these devices, from a USB stick, gets around that, correct?
Well, if it's a software keylogger, I have some hardware keyloggers with me.
And
I think. Check.
Is there a way that you can advise us how we get around keyloggers, and or if there are, we know they're on our devices, how we can see where they're sending, where they're calling home, and try and identify where it's going?
Yes.
Is that something you can do in a Raspberry Pi or something like that? And the second question is, given the fact that we're all activists and we're probably under surveillance, they have a lot of technology, but they're pretty stupid people. How do we yank their chains and have fun with the fight? Because unless we're having a good time and fun with the fight, then it just becomes onerous. But let's have a good time when we're fighting back.
Yes?
That was my two questions.
Yes. Okay, I'll try to answer them. So I have does anybody here have a computer, like a laptop or something? Because I have a kind of cool device with me. I buy forensics related stuff all the time because the best way to beat forensics people at their own game is to get their stuff, figure out how it works, and then ruin it for them. Right? I mean, it's like anything. Okay. But we don't need to plug it in. You can just pass this around. This is what's called this is the lamest thing ever, but it's at least instructive. So when you have, I'll explain it. It's called a mouse jiggler. It does exactly what it sounds like. What you do is you plug it into your computer, and if you have a Windows machine or a Mac, it doesn't seem to work very well on Linux, which is hilarious. You plug it in, and it just pretends to be a mouse and moves the mouse around the computer screen so the screensaver doesn't activate. And forensics people use this combined with power splitters to be able to move a computer while it's on, even if it's plugged into the wall. And then the screensaver doesn't activate. So they plug this in and they do this power jacking thing. There's a thing called a HotPlug by a company called WiebeTech. They're the same people that make this mouse jiggler. And it's for, law enforcement forensics, and I bought it, which is great. And thanks so much.
That's
awesome, thanks. That's great. That's solidarity right there. Woohoo, molecular solidarity. Anybody want to try this out on their computer and see if it jiggles their mouse? Sure. Yeah, if you do, here, let me just I'll toss it to you. Good catch, fantastic. Please return it to me though, because I only have a couple of them and I'm trying to make it so when you plug it into a computer, it automatically turns off. I want to make it so that my Linux box, when you plug in a forensics device, it's like attempted theft detected, power down.
Nice.
Right? Right? So that's an example, it's super simple to do. The device has unique identifiers, and you plug it in, it actually calls itself a mouse jiggler. So auto-detecting cop, found, shutting down computer, alert, right? So it's kind of like, that's a thing. So you're talking about keyloggers. If there's a keylogger like that, built into, you plug a keyboard into it and it records everything in line, booting off of Tails will not help you. But Tails has an on-screen keyboard you can click with your mouse. So if there's a keylogger built in, when you type in your passphrase, you can type part of it in that, for example. And there's other stuff that you can do, which might be useful, right? So some of that stuff is there. But if it's a software keylogger, and it never runs, because you have Windows on your computer or something, and you boot Tails, well, the Windows software is never executed. But if they've compromised your computer, they can compromise your BIOS, they can compromise the actual other computers inside of your computer. Because really, that's what a computer is. It's a series of other computers hooked up. And they're just little smaller computers that do different jobs. Excuse me. So I think that answers your first question. Your second question.
Keyloggers are calling home.
Oh, yeah. So, okay. So if you have a keylogger, let's separate this. There's a thing that's called a Trojan or a backdoor, right? Those devices allow someone to remotely access your computer or they allow you to automatically phones home, for example, and sends data about you. I feel so sad when I hear that sound in activist rooms. It's 10 years of working with NGOs, it's like, you have booted Windows. Yeah, so, I mean, it's great. I mean, the people that work at Microsoft have done a lot for security on Windows. It's actually really great, but they also now own Skype, and they promised that they're gonna do so-called lawful interception with Skype. So as good as they are, they're not fighting the fight against so-called lawful intercept. So if you have one of these keyloggers that is a software keylogger, the hardware keylogger almost certainly isn't reporting home. Now, you can build a hardware keylogger that transmits something. If you do, there's a thing, it's called technical counter-surveillance, basically. You can try to do technical counter-surveillance measures to find something like that. That's a total nightmare. There are people you can hire to do it. A couple people in the I think in Maine maybe, or maybe in Rhode Island, that do this, but I think that they won't tell you if it's a government bug. Like, if they find a government bug, they leave it. I'm not totally sure. Like, I do my own technical counter surveillance for myself, and I think I do a shitty job at it. And I think it's a hard problem. So I think it's like, is it jiggling your mouse?
Yeah,
show that to everybody. So this is a forensics tool which, when plugged in, makes it so her screensaver will never activate. So that's a really lame attack, by the way. Like, I cannot stress how lame that is. It identifies itself as a forensics device. They might change it. Ironically, they can't identify as the Microsoft mouse without licensing that. So you think Microsoft wants to license that? I mean, they can obviously change it. Like, a really talented forensics person is not going to be tripped up by that. But if you're going to be targeted by a really talented forensics person, hopefully you already know that ahead of time and you've taken appropriate countermeasures, right? Be careful, basically. So the phoning home thing, yes, you can detect phoning home software. So, like, you can sometimes have like a firewall on your computer, and if there is a piece of malware or a Trojan or a backdoor of some kind that's trying to make a connection out, you might be able to detect it. If it's good malware, it will override that firewall automatically. Like, I'm pretty sure this telephone has something similar to that. I had, like, after the talk that Benny and I gave at Democracy Now!, I noticed that the firewall on this telephone, written by Moxie Marlinspike, because this is one of his Android phones that he made, I noticed that it, like, started resetting itself from time to time, and it's like, oh gosh, what happened there? All of a sudden, my firewall, like, was gone, and then it restarted, and it's like, it happens periodically. Interesting, weird. I mean, I don't know that my phone is compromised, but it's like pretty sure bet that it is. So, you know, you're not going to really detect something like that, but if you see really strange behavior, you can usually find someone. And in this community, there are a bunch of really smart technical people who are also friendly, not always, sometimes difficult to talk to, but still worth talking to. And they might be able to help you with that. But using software that's like, find spyware, find malware, that's not going to find the FBI's malware or spyware, just to be clear about that.
No, what about a Wireshark or something like that, where it has to call home on a network?
Yep.
And so.
Okay, so you're one of the tech ops people, obviously. So yes, you can. What you need to do, if you want to catch these things, here's what you do. You have like a cell phone base station that I mentioned, like say OpenBTS or OpenBSC, and you have, sorry for this is going to get technical for about 30 seconds. You have this cell phone tower. Your phone joins the tower. You run the tower, you inspect all the traffic. If you see anything going to places that you do not expect, or things where the phone doesn't record that it's making that connection, but the tower does, the discrepancy is an example of something being wrong. Now you really know what to home in on, which is, here's a connection which my firewall didn't log, but I saw the connection being made, right? So that's a thing, because our phones don't have IMSI catcher built in by default. Backdoors don't know if they're on an IMSI catcher. So it cuts both ways, right? So that's a possibility. And if you have a laptop that you think is compromised, you can plug it into, say, like an Ethernet cable. If it's a really simple backdoor that just tries to connect back, you can use something like Wireshark to sniff the Ethernet connection between the laptop and the internet. You totally can do that. You have to really know what you're doing to not misdiagnose and cry wolf. So you have to be really careful about that. So yes, you can do that. That is a forensics process for looking for a system being compromised. So like if someone sends you a suspect PDF and is like, hey, Occupy Wall Street person, open this or open this Microsoft doc, you know, make a collection of those things. You might find people doing targeted attacks against you. You know, there are some people in the New York area, which I know are super brutal jerks, and they have tried to do that kind of stuff. And so, I mean, they're regularly harassing people online and all that stuff. And, you know, those people, I think, will get caught eventually. And you can catch them, and then you can expose them. I mean, it's actually quite funny when the police end up abusing their authority, and you catch them doing that because, you know, they're the ones that are supposed to be legitimate. So as soon as they prove themselves to be not legitimate, there's a sort of legitimacy crisis, if you will, which is good, you know. So you can do that. You can find that. And then to return to the world of non-technical, because it's incredibly boring to talk just about technical stuff when only a few people might want to hear about that, I think that I don't have an answer to how to make it fun. Because it is incredibly oppressive and incredibly depressing and very heavy and serious shit to be targeted by the state. And if I could go back in time and do it all over again, I would do a lot of things differently. But I wouldn't change the main thrust, right? But to give you an example, just a simple example, I'm a really big fan of canned nuts that actually have prank snakes inside of them. And so a lot of the times when I fly, I put in my suitcase things like that. Like, whatever you do, officer, do not open that suitcase. there is a flying snake inside of it. And then they say, like, oh, that's, what? And then they open it, and I'm like, no, don't open that. Do not open that can of nuts. I'm telling you, don't do that. And whatever you do, don't look into it with good remaining eye. And you know, like, that honestly, I think that that's helpful, right? I think part of the resistance there, it's not productive for positive interactions with those guys. But it is incredibly helpful for morale. Because being targeted by the state, it's important to do that, right? I mean, my partner, for example, who I don't really talk about in public very much, has been targeted, I think, by the FBI, where they watch my partner sleeping naked and, you know, with night vision goggles on my partner's property, watching through the window. It went pretty well with no pronouns there. So it's a really a chore to do that. So that, to me, is really scary. That we live in the world where you can't tell the difference between what we think is the state and what is otherwise like something you would like shoot a criminal trespass person for potentially if you were a gun carrying kind of person. That's really scary. In situations like that, I don't think canned snakes are the answer. It's really funny, right? You have to have a sense of humor about these things. I don't know if you've ever seen the Italian movie Life is Beautiful. Have any of you guys seen this at all? Okay. So there are a few movies I highly recommend. So Das Leben der Andeles, or Des Andeles, which is The Lives of Others. Really fantastic movie, one of the best movies ever made, ever, hands down. It's a German movie. If you can't handle subtitles, learn German. It's worth it, it's really great. And of course, Life is Beautiful is a story about a father and a son who were trapped in the Holocaust. And the way that the father deals with it and teaches the son to deal with it, which is really beautiful, is by using humor. Even when he's being marched off to have terrible things happen to him, he always tries to instill a sense of hope and a sense of positivity in his son using humor. And, you know, it's a Holocaust film, so it's like, you know, not really that cheery, but it's beautiful because resistance can be beautiful even if you lose, because the whole time that you're resisting, you're still making a positive outcome in the end, especially if you're effective. And I highly recommend just comedy for anything you can. And try to do it in a way where you're not making fun of the person. Maybe you make fun of yourself. I mean, I think that that's a really great thing to do. So it's also interesting from the perspective of being intimidated. So one of the times that I was detained, they denied me, well, most of the times they detained me at the airport, they denied me access to a lawyer and to a bathroom, but gave me water, right? And so it's like, in situations like that, I think the best thing you can do is to humiliate them by asking them to give you mercy to use the bathroom, and when you don't, just pissing all over yourself and all over them, and saying, like, how dehumanizing it is, and just telling the truth. And it's not really funny, but there's a lot of humility involved in something like that, and it really gets those people, I think about the kind of world that they're creating. And there are people that are in that situation that realize that that's not the kind of world they want to create. And just taking it is not always the right answer, but in a situation like that, that might work. I haven't had the opportunity to do that, but I don't think that that is like below anybody. I don't think that's a tactic that isn't worth doing. But when in doubt, I think humor is the right way to go. So glitter, snakes and cans, very useful, weird underwear, like ask strange questions. And you know, I mean, ask strange questions, but in general, if you can, one of my favorite techniques is after they screw with you, the next time you see the same people again, which I've had this experience where I'm detained in an airport, and then the next time I go to the same airport, I'm detained by the same people, and they say, gosh, how hard was that for you? Don't speak. Like, don't say a single word at all. Not a single word, no matter what. The awkwardness of people who feel like they're in control, not being able to elicit a single sentence from you, or even a yes or a no or a nod, it's so fantastic. I mean, it's really up there, right? Because it's one of those things where they basically beg you to just acknowledge them. And you're like, no, you were a total jerk to me last time. But you don't say that. And they know it. That is something which really builds morale. Because in the end, when they eventually have to let you go, especially if you're a U.S. citizen re-entering the United States, I mean, it might take a while, right? You have to be willing to take it a little bit harder in those cases. But when that actually happens, it's a totally different dynamic. I mean, there's a guy from the Sea Shepherd who was being interrogated And I believe it was like 6 hours where he didn't even acknowledge their existence. And at the very end, they're like, are you even going to acknowledge that we're in the room? And he didn't. And they're like, fuck this guy. And then just left. That guy must have felt like $1 million at the end of that. Like, I mean, if you've ever been interrogated by people like this, you know that there is a certain sense of satisfaction in knowing that if you said something that they could get you with, they would get you with it. And the fact they can't get anything is a total sense of failure, which you, in some cases, since they're usually doing it for the wrong reasons and often illegally, often immorally and unethically, it's those cases where it's really powerful to be able to have that upper hand where you just stay silent and they really literally don't even have a word from you. And I mean, I don't know if that answers it. I also think free love is a big part of it, but I'm kidding, sort of.
If this has happened to you, I think it's very important to stay verbal and visible and talk about how idiotic they are.
Well, maybe. So it's a position of privilege, right? Like, I'm a white man with an American passport, right? And I use that because every Muslim American detained since September 11th doesn't have that same position of privilege, necessarily. And they might do it, but it's not the same. And it's very easy for me to stand up by comparison. And so I think everyone has to make a personal choice about that. Like, for example, Laura here, who's filming me, did not come out in public about it for quite some time, only when they threatened to handcuff her for taking notes. And Glenn Greenwald wrote about this, and I think that's powerful. But I at no point felt like she should come forward until she decided to do so. And people should try to stay visible about it, and people should talk about what's going on, because there is, I think, a new COINTELPRO. And I think it's way bigger than before. But we should never give people a hard time for the choices they make as autonomous individuals where they don't always choose to stand up to take on the state, because the state is like serious. It's really serious. And so we shouldn't give people a hard time about that. I can't stress that enough, because this stuff eats away at your soul. I mean, I don't even believe that we have souls, but I mean, you get the idea, right? I mean, like, it really is poisonous, and people will cease to associate with you. There's a real chilling effect on every aspect of your life and how you perceive it. So we have to be in solidarity even if we make different choices, and that mutual aid that comes from that means that some people who do speak out, who do have it harder, I think we do need to support them. But there are plenty of people who will suffer in silence because they have a job where they'll lose the job if they're associated with something, or they'll lose a family member, or they'll lose something else. Or they'll attract the kind of attention that they can't stand up to. And maybe they're not in a position of privilege, like they have cancer and they smoke marijuana and they work at a government with like federal funds, like a government job, like a university. That person can't stand up the same way that I'll stand up, because I don't care what they do to me by comparison. And I have that privilege. So we have to maybe help people to get that privilege, but we shouldn't take that and just for granted, right? I mean, it's a thing that people do, but they don't have to do.
I agree, but I'm just saying, if it happens to you, one option is to be very verbal and visible and make fun of all the things that are happening, too. Because if it's fun, then people want to listen to the outrageous things that are happening. So.
Yeah, I mean, I totally agree. You just have to be strategic about the whole thing, right? You have tactics to achieve a certain outcome. That's the strategy, the overall strategy. And I think that a really big part of that is to figure it out on your own and to talk about it with people. You know, to that effect, talking about it on the phone is not a great idea. So when you use the telephone, you should consider, for example, not using names or places or details, unless you're talking about things where you feel the state has oppressed you, because I cannot imagine a better transcript in court than the wiretap of you talking about police brutality, where then the wiretappers didn't report the police for their brutality. That sounds like a great thing, right? But don't talk about, you know, your action with Bob over the phone, like the guy in the place, you know, like something like that. That's great. A better solution than even that, even if you continue to do that kind of stuff, is to talk using something like, for example, Redphone, which is a secure Android calling solution by Moxie Marlinspike, which is currently not out anymore, but it will be out again, I believe. There's a thing called CSIP Simple, I think is what it's called. It's a SIP phone, which has a thing called ZRTP, which is a encrypted voice over IP telephone. So now when they do the interception between two calls, it's encrypted, and if they steal the phones, the data is worthless because the keys are thrown away at the end of the call. Right? There's a thing that's called private GSM. Private GSM is actually for iPhone, for Android, for BlackBerry, for all these things, but it's commercial software, which is built on the ZRTP protocol. that you can install on basically every smartphone, and it's great against passive attackers. So if you're just worried about someone intercepting the data, that is very useful. In that if you have that, the interception of that data, it's forward secret. If you authenticate by saying the word that's on your screen, if the other person says the word and you recognize their voice, it's not like a police officer's like, yeah, flatfoot Eskimo, hey, right? So if your friend's normally, you know, hello, then clearly something has gone wrong, right? So if you authenticate your friend, right, that's, yeah, bit of a comedian. If you do that, that gives you something really useful. But that doesn't protect you against a laser microphone pointed at your window, right? In that case, buy a radar detector for speeding and put that in your window too, right? Do you guys catch what I just said?
Yeah.
Laser microphone pointed at your window, right? If you have a laser microphone pointed at your window, what is it? It's a laser. And what can you do with a laser? You use laser detectors to detect lasers. It's not perfect, but if the laser sweeps across the radar detector, laser detector, which is normally used for checking for police radar, I think that you might have some interesting results with that. Another thing to do is buy a laser microphone and test this theory and see if it works. Right? If you're going to do counter-surveillance, try to do the counter-surveillance against your friends to see if it works. Because if you don't try and you just assume it works, probably something will go wrong. And it will be something that is difficult to think of. So pair up with someone who's a tech ops person and figure this out and try to do that. Right? So encrypted voice RP, not going to protect you. It's not going to protect you from someone who's laser miking your house or from a snitch at your meeting. Right? Another useful thing to do is to actually, in the situations where you have a bunch of people in a room, one of the things I like to do is what I call the phone bag. So you go to a party and you set the social expectation of we're at a party or we're at a meeting or we're having dinner and the point is to talk to each other. Everybody put your phone in the bag. And everybody puts their phone in the bag and you put it in the freezer or in the fridge or you just put it in the bathroom, someplace, right? Where if it's being wiretapped, no interesting conversation is taking place. It's a totally different experience when people are not dicking around with their telephones. But it's also a totally different experience when people do not have the same nagging fear of not knowing if they are being surveilled. So that's a totally non-technical thing that works for every telephone, right? Just put the phones in a bag and hope that the people you're with won't take all the phones. I mean, there's a risk, right? So, I mean, I've been to parties where, you know, when we did that, and I say party very loosely, it wasn't much fun, but, you know, some of the phones weren't there at the end of the night. So that could be a problem. But if you encrypt it and you're not worried about theft, like maybe you can solve that problem too. Another useful thing is if you have an Android phone, there's a thing that's called Text Secure, and it's in the Android market. So every person with Android can install this right now, as is private GSM, actually. It's also in the Android market. Text Secure is encrypted text messaging where recording all the text messages, which, by the way, basically happens. Every text message you send is probably, depending on your cell phone provider, it's probably archived. There are a few exceptions, but the big ones, they either hand the data off directly to the government or they log that data. So if you're like, meet me at Zuccotti Park at 2 p.m. so that we can burn this flag, for example, and you send that via text message, like, there are a couple copies of that before being targeted, and later they can look at it. So that's a pretty easy to solve thing, though. With Text Secure, you can use this and you can say, meet me at Zuccotti Park, the crow flies at midnight, and it's encrypted, and the data that they have logged, they just see noise. I mean, they see something that looks like encryption. It's not actually noise, but it's like a normal text message with the data being undecipherable without knowing the math problem solution. And this is based on a protocol that's called off-the-record messaging. And so off-the-record messaging is awesome. It is, has anybody here ever heard of PGP?
Yes.
Okay, who hasn't heard of PGP? Okay, real quick crypto tutorial. Math is hard. Certain kinds of math is harder than other kinds of math. Using hard mathematics, where we define hard as difficult to do in a finite amount of time, then we can make certain problems which are easy for you to solve, but are difficult for anybody else to solve. One of the ways that we do this is with a thing called asymmetric cryptography. You have what's called a public key. This is the key you give to everyone in the public. And you have a private key. This is the key that's on your computer and no one else has access to it. And it's usually encrypted with a passphrase. The private key is usually encrypted with what's called symmetric cryptography. That means given just the key, you can decrypt like the passphrase, for example, given just the passphrase, you can decrypt that private key. So they're usually combined. But what you usually do is you get my public key, and then you encrypt a message to my public key. The public key tells you how to send me an encrypted message. And you include with that, or if we're smart, we exchange this in person, you include in some way a public key. This is a classic crypto problem of what's called key exchange. If you don't know if you have the right key for your friend, you can be encrypting messages to the police. It'll be perfectly secure, and they get everything. So you have to make sure that the key that you have matches the key that your friend expects you to have, or your associate. One way to do this is that the first key that's given to you, if you don't have a real world link to them, you make sure that it doesn't change. But that's a crappy way to do it. The right way to do it is to compare what's called a fingerprint, or cryptographic fingerprint. So these public keys and private keys can form what's called an identity. PGP has this problem, which is that when you encrypt me an email and you send it to me, and then the police break into my computer and they get my key, my private key, they can decrypt the message you sent to me. And it has to be that way so that I can read the mail in the first place. Does anybody not follow that? That was a lot. So does anybody want me to go back a little bit? Okay. Public key. It's the key that you generate. It's a really large number, let's say. And it just says, like, begin PGP public key. You give that to me. When I have that, I know how to send an encrypted message to you. The only person that can open that, if we understand the math correctly, which I think that people who are way smarter than me understand this better, only person that can decrypt that is you with your private key. We both have public keys, we both have private keys. We have to exchange our public keys so we know how to encrypt to each other. That means that we have the ability to send each other securely encrypted messages. We have to verify that the keys that we are using are what we think. So if you sent me a public key, or you sent me a public key, or you sent me a public key, and then I would call you on the phone, maybe, with my encrypted voice over IP phone, and I would say, hey, tell me what your fingerprint is. And that's how I would verify what your key is. And the fingerprint is a summary of the public key. So the public key is really long, and the fingerprint is like a smaller condensed version. And in theory, it's very difficult, if you read the whole fingerprint, for that to be forged by someone. It's more likely that they'll break into your computer and take it. But what that means is we can now send each other encrypted messages that are really hard to decrypt. And that has, I think, quite a lot of value to it, but there is this big downside, which is that if they get your private key, they can read all the encrypted mails. Off-the-record messaging is just like PGP, except that when they get the key, they can't decrypt the conversation. Does that sound fucking awesome? Okay, so here's how it works. You have a communications channel with someone. Like, anybody here ever use Google Chat? Jabber, anybody ever use Jabber at all? Okay. Anybody ever use Jitsi? Yeah. Anybody ever use AOL Instant Messenger? Yeah. Anybody ever use the internet? Are you guys even awake? What the fuck is going on here? Okay. I'm sorry, I'm boring the shit out of you. This is a long one. All right. I'm going to try to go through this a little bit more succinctly, mostly because I have a really horrible cramp in my leg. But,
You got 20 minutes.
Cool. Right on. Awesome. We'll just do some yoga after this. Okay, cool. Well, I have to meet a really strange person after this, so I'll have to go. But OTR basically solves the PGP problem by making it that those keys are only useful for identifying yourself. So, you know, let's say that you set up a conversation with me. We're chatting on Google Chat, or we're using RiseUp's Jabber server, which is better than Google Chat because it's not controlled by Google. Or by someone else, right? You want to diversify. It's not that one is necessarily better than the other. They all have similar problems. But by diversifying, it makes it a lot harder to get everything, right? Compartmentalization is the most important skill to learn. If you take anything away, compartmentalize the things that you do. So that if you build a system, you don't put the website with all the members' names on the same system as like the really vulnerable web application or the laptop you take across the border without encryption, right? Separate those systems. Do the same thing for social stuff. Compartmentalization is what allows us to survive when certain things are compromised, or taken, stolen, or harmed in some way without harming all those other things, right? We do this all the time in our lives anyway. But compartmentalization of keys, in this case, is really great. So what OTR does is that I communicate with this guy in the front row, and I'm like, hey, you want to use OTR? He says, yeah, I want to use OTR. And we do a key exchange automatically. We don't have to do anything. So if you're using a program called Adium on macOS, or if you're using a thing called Pigeon with the OTR plugin on Linux, or Windows or whatever, or if you're using Jitsi on basically any platform, there's a whole bunch of chat clients, they just have OTR built in by default. So without you knowing that this has happened, there is an encrypted communications channel, and it's an unverified one. So just automatically it's encrypted. And the key for that session is unique to that setup. But the identity for that computer stays the same. So you verify the identity of the person, and then you verify maybe the session by saying verify. And it has this feature in some versions called the Socialist Millionaires Protocol, which means you type in a word like, or a question, and the question is like, what was Bob doing last week? And then you can say like, saluting the flag, right? When that happens, the Socialist Millionaires Protocol allows someone else to send you a guess without revealing what the guess is. It's an incredible trick. And it's pretty complicated. I don't actually totally understand the way that it works. It's a thing called a zero knowledge proof, which is like kind of dumbfounding to me in some ways. But the basic idea is that you can prove whether or not you have given the same answer on both sides without revealing what the answer actually is. And using that, you don't have to read out the fingerprint, but you can also just read out the fingerprint. If the identity matches, even if Google is logging that data, when you click end the conversation or you quit the chat client, the keys for that session are destroyed. And that's it, you're done. The data they logged about you is worthless, right? So if you're using the Jitsi chat client and you verify the identity, and this is the most important part, trust but verify, you verify the identity of the person some way, maybe by making a Jitsi call to them and saying like, hey, this is an encrypted call. How you doing? Yeah, can you read your fingerprint? And they're like, yeah, sure, well, let's talk a little bit so we know that we are who we say we are. It's like, okay, well, every now and then in the middle of talking, I want you to emphasize one of the letters in the sentence you're saying or for your fingerprint. So it's like, hey, my name is Bob and I'm going to have pizza, right? Or something like that, right? And you can encode this into what you're saying so that you really believe that. A better way to do it is to write it down and exchange it in person, you know, and then burn it when you're done. I don't know. That you know, it's up to you how you want to deal with that. But by verifying that, you only verify the identity keys. Now if someone breaks in and takes your computer, they can impersonate you, right? But they will not be able to take the previously logged messages and decrypt them because those keys are not useful for decrypting. They're only useful for identification. So this solves the PGP problem. So with PGP, you can encrypt your email. With OTR, you can encrypt your chats. With something like Jitsi, you can encrypt your voice over IP calls. With C Simple, with private GSM, with things like Redphone, you can do the same thing for voice over IP calls. With TechSecure, you get OTR for SMS. So now when they log your SMSs, it's worthless. The data is encrypted and you know they might as well just throw it away.
So if you want to use this, does the other person that you're texting have to be using it as well?
Yeah, so the way that this works is it's called end-to-end encryption, right? Both clients support it and the security is as good as those clients. So if someone has a backdoor on their computer which allows the police to see their screen, like a Finn Fisher backdoor, which is sort of the canonical for-profit mercenary software, that, you know, you don't beat that, right? So Skype is encrypted. The way that the German police beat it is by breaking into the computer and getting full screen captures. They never even attack the crypto. Which, by the way, who's using Skype in the room? Stop. Don't even raise your hand. I don't want to know. Talk to this guy about using Jitsi instead. It's not perfect, but if Microsoft wants to build in so-called lawful interception, you better believe it's going to happen. Also, every time you log into a computer using Skype, you have two problems. The first problem is if there are vulnerabilities in Skype, and someone in the vulnerability market buys an exploit or buys a vulnerability or buys an exploit for that vulnerability, then they're going to use Skype as the vector for breaking into your computer to install that government backdoor, for example, or just a homegrown backdoor or whatever. The second problem is that when you log in and you type in your passphrase, you have given up your login credentials and all that stuff to Skype. And usually at that point, it pulls down chat logs and information about you, and like all of a sudden, all your contacts are there. Well, how is that possible? Anybody have a guess? Skype has it and promises not to give it away. Now, that doesn't mean Skype is bad for all cases. In fact, in a lot of cases, it's fine. Like if you were going to live stream something. Personally, I don't even install the software on my computer because I don't trust it at all. It's basically designed like malware. If you try to inspect to see what it's doing, it stops you or kills itself. that's a bad sign. It's software that is essentially not friendly. It's certainly not free software. So using something like Jitsi is an alternative that's already been built that has almost all the same features. But it also has OTR, it's also decentralized in a useful way, and it also is verifiable. And it's built on open standards and peer-reviewed designs. That's like really an important thing. If you can't review it, even if you have all the knowledge in the universe, don't trust it. And don't even waste your time reviewing it if there's something similar that you can review. So just pick the thing like Jitsi instead of Skype. If your enemy is, of course, like the Syrian government or something, I think Skype is probably better than nothing at all. But it's not going to be worthwhile to do that if there's a bug in Skype, because then maybe they can break into your computer. And Jitsi is obviously not bug-free either, but I trust Jitsi in a lot of ways more than Skype. So let's see. We've got encrypted voice over IP, which includes voice and video chat. We've got text messaging. We've got the ability to make VoIP calls on cell phones of all different types. There's also a thing called cryptophone, which allows you to make encrypted satellite telephone calls as well. Those guys are badass. They basically pioneered the entire field of encrypted communications that wasn't done by the government. They're from Germany, cryptophone.de. They're working on a voice over IP software client, and they also have satellite telephones and they have GSM telephones. So like one of the phones that was taken from me when I was taken, and I can't talk about what happened to my phones, but one of those phones was a crypto phone. So it's like, you know, interesting thing there. Those phones are really great. They're a little expensive, but it depends on what you're trying to do. Like having one of those is maybe useful for like the main legal contact of an organization or something.
You seem to talk about Android a lot, and you haven't said much about the iPhone. Is Android a better option? And I know they're both probably pretty bad. Is Android better?
Well, it depends. Like for targeted exploitation, I think the iPhone is a lot safer. But with Android, you get a lot of diversity. You get the ability to reflash your phone, you get the ability to change stuff, you get the ability to, you know, route it so that you can route all your traffic over Tor. Maybe if you're lucky, you get an Android phone that doesn't even have a cell phone built into it, it's just a Wi-Fi tablet. I think there's a lot of value. I think there's a lot of value in being able to do that. Like we have Tor, we have like a little Tor-like browser. There's a thing called Gibberbot on Android. It's a chat client, like a Jabber chat client with OTR that connects over Tor automatically on Android. Just type in your login and password and you're done. No configuration required. That, I think, is very powerful. It's not really possible to do that right now on the iPhone. There are some people working on a Tor browser for the iPhone. But again, right, like these devices, these are stopgap solutions. So you want to protect your, you know, I'm taking the bus. That's what I use my phone for. It's like, I'm going to take the bus. I would like it if my cell phone carrier didn't know that. Right? But I don't trust it with something serious. I'm like, well, the iPhone might be difficult to tactically exploit. I have no doubt that it might have like carrier IQ and report data about me back. It may be that I'm a high value enough target that they compromise the iPhone. And I think if you're gonna make the choice about building a better world, you gotta try to make the world a better place in all aspects of your life. And one part of that is to work on building free and open source, but free software and free hardware alternatives. And Android is a step in that direction. And it has a shitty user interface. It's totally painful to use. It's not great. Like, I'm not gonna argue that it is. And if you already have an iPhone, I think selling the iPhone is not the right answer either. But just knowing the limits of the devices is a very powerful thing. And to that extent, I sort of wanted to make sure that I actually talked about a couple of things before this ends. So I wanted to talk about one thing real quick, which is, who here has ever had someone break into their house when they weren't home, but nothing was stolen? Anybody? So the government has the ability with the Patriot Act to do what's called a sneak and peek or a black bag job, where basically they can break into your house and plant stuff or search your house and never give you a search warrant and never tell you that it happened. Sounds like crazy Philip K. Dick stuff, right? Well, maybe, I don't know, in the movie The Lives of Others, what the Stasi did, which I think is an instructive thing, is that when the neighbor saw the Stasi breaking into the main character's house, they just let the main character's neighbor know that if she said anything, that her children would not get into college. Right? And this is the thing that happens, right? I mean, who's been threatened by the police here? Anybody? Yeah, okay. So, I mean, it's probably non-zero. I know that it's non-zero for me. Who here actually feels like they are under surveillance pretty regularly? Everyone inside of Occupy. Who here was...
Physical surveillance, person, people?
Like, do you feel like you're being followed by people?
Not electronic, followed.
Anybody physically surveilled at all? A few people? Okay. I mean, other than right now by Laura. So how many people here have been arrested and had their, at their court date, they had their phone taken into the back room? How many people here had their retina scanned? Wow. I would highly encourage resisting that tactic. When they ask for your retina, I would sit in jail for 2 days. Once you disclose it, there's no way that you can ever get it out of their database. Okay, so that's the... I mean, CryptoCat is... real quick, a question. CryptoCat is this question of whether or not it's useful. It's experimental software. I wouldn't trust it with my life. I think the author is a really nice guy, and I've worked a little bit on it, but I think fundamentally it's an experiment. So just keep that in mind. So the Guardian project is an attempt to create a secure Android phone and a suite of tools. So for example, they have a thing called Obscura Cam where you can take a picture of police brutality and then in the photograph select a region where the activist's face in the background is blurred out so that you can make sure that the cop is brought to justice, but the people who are just innocent bystanders are not being targeted for repression. So Guardian is trying to build a whole bunch of these tools for use actually all around the planet, but one of the use cases is also here, right? So Guardian has a whole selection of things, and we ported Tor to Android with the Guardian project originally. I did that with Nathan here in New York City.
Can I ask another question? How many people who are active in Occupy have traveled outside of the country and returned home since Occupy began?
Anybody here?
Anyone question?
So I've heard that some people involved with Occupy have been interrogated by the U.S. government about Occupy when returning to the United States, which if...
That happened to you?
Did that happen to you?
But in Miami, we've actually had a few people arrested and interrogated by FBI, including a guy from Occupy.
Some people have been stopped and interrogated on domestic flights by the TSA.
And interrogated?
Yes.
What kinds of questions?
Just asking about involvement for Mayday, asking about specific project names and their involvement in that.
Okay, so.
Can I give out my website? I'd be interested in documenting any of these cases that we've had regarding surveillance and targeting of activists.
Which website?
So my website is praxisfilms.com.
Praxisfilms.com.
Praxis. P-R-A-X-I-S. Films.com, and there's
a info
contact information.
People are not producing counter surveillance.
Can I have a question
about that? Yeah. If and when they do interrogate anyone, what is it the same legal issue where if you're in jail, you're not legally required to answer any questions, or you have to answer any questions?
You don't have to ever talk to the pigs. Don't do it. It doesn't matter which pigs they are, whether they're border pigs or whether they're NYPD pigs. Like, just don't, like, this little piggy didn't get a word from me.
Okay.
Okay. And I think they're going to tell you otherwise. They're going to say, we're not going to let you back into the country or something like that. Now, the TSA might stop you from boarding a plane, for example. Yeah. You have to be willing to be punished for not answering them. But you absolutely are not required when you re-enter the United States to say a single word to those people, not one. And I've done it. I've re-entered and not said a single word. And you can do it too. A while. No, the last 4 or 5 times that I've flown, they haven't done that, which, fascinating how that happens. I filed like a bunch of bureaucratic paperwork and maybe that helped solve it, but I was also detained after they acknowledged my bureaucratic paperwork, so I don't know. They also told me in the bureaucratic response to that paperwork that I, you know, would still have to deal with random security screenings where random is the same number every time we roll a dice. I mean, like, no, they're trying to intimidate other people. They know for sure that they will never intimidate me. Like, that's not going to happen. I have no fear from these people. Like, compared to what I have heard about the 20th century, like, these guys are just, like, a joke. You know? Like, this isn't School of America's types of stuff. These guys aren't the Nazi party, right? These guys don't even think they're evil. They're just, like, accidentally shitty in most cases. And so I don't find them to be scary at all. I mean, But I'm also not having someone put a gun in my face like what Bill Binney had happen to him when the FBI raided his house. I would find that to be totally intimidating. Not that they should do that, but there's an example of when you're under surveillance, how you like check yourself. But you know, that's gonna happen. All I can know is that I have had a clean conscience and I'm doing the things that I believe in to make the world a better place, so.
Do you want to repeat, I have a closing statement you and Bill made at
I will in a second. So here's the deal. It is 2:53. I have five more things I want to cover. If no one asks any more questions until we're done, I might be able to finish it in 7 minutes, which would be exactly 3 o'clock. Is that something you guys want me to try to do?
Yes.
Okay, all right, so anyone that interrupts me, it will not be possible for me to do that. Is it also, is it possible to run over for 5 minutes? Is that?
Yeah. We can run over here, I was worried about
yourself. Oh yeah, so I'm not meeting the crazy, weird, got a meeting until four. So I mean, I have a little bit of leeway. Okay, so I highly encourage everyone here to use a system like RiseUp instead of Gmail, and to give RiseUp some cash for the services that they offer, and to encourage RiseUp to run some servers outside of the United States. Say like, we're Occupy Wall Street, we would really like to all have RiseUp accounts on a server hosted in Sweden, or in a server hosted in Czechoslovakia. We would be willing to kick that in. What would it cost you to put a server up for us there? That might be useful for you. And especially if you connect over Tor to use that server, that might be really powerful for you. Using the RiseUp, we.riseup.net, the crabgrass instance for organizing instead of Facebook, you still have to trust RiseUp. But if you have to make a choice between trusting Facebook and RiseUp, who do you trust? Like, it's totally obvious, right? I mean, at the same time, that doesn't mean that someone might not break into the server and get it, right? So crabgrass, even though I think the guys that wrote it and the girls that wrote it, I think that they're awesome, that doesn't mean it's perfect. Breaking into a computer is a thing that can happen. So if you trust your data to that system, you know, be careful. Like, so use nicknames, don't use the same nickname everywhere you go, right? You don't want to link your identities by using the same identifiers all the time. So create a RiseUp account, create like a we.riseup crabgrass instance and use that for posting stuff. Like, for example, I highly encourage people to make a Piggypedia. In Egypt, what happened, I'll explain. The Piggypedia in the Egyptian Revolution in Tahrir, what was done was they took photographs of all the agent provocateurs, all of the snitches, and all of the military people, and all of the cops, and they put them on Flickr, and they called it the Piggypedia. It's like the Wikipedia, but for pigs. Now, it's not nice to say that about pigs, because pigs are animals that we love, and we shouldn't eat. But the thing is that I think that is a catchy thing, and it's worth sticking with that in solidarity with the Egyptians who chose that phrase. No insult meant to little animals that we call pigs. But putting that on something like crabgrass, that's going to stay up a lot longer than if you put up a Facebook page about cops in New York that beat the shit out of protesters, right? So why use Facebook for anything, right? The answer is the network effect. If everybody's on Facebook, there's a power in being on that too. But you guys all have a giant network. Make the transition to places like RiseUp instead of using and empowering Facebook. It's really hard to do that, but it's worth doing it. And I really encourage you guys to do that. Additionally, I would say, someone asked about, what do you do about like radio emissions for the Tempest stuff where they maybe are monitoring you? There's a thing that's called the Faraday cage. You can buy shielding, but if you have electricity and you plug into it, it leaves your house. That's where the electricity comes from. So it's pretty hard to get real isolation in entirety. But you could have a room that doesn't have, for example, electricity in it, and it is electronically shielded. That makes it a lot harder for someone to put an electronic bug inside of the room and have it be able to transmit out, but it's not impossible. So you can take those steps, but sometimes the best way to win is not to play on that field. And so, picking a random place and not bringing your cell phones, like going to the swimming pool, like a public swimming pool, and getting like a water, like a giant plastic dish and going underwater is probably way more effective than trying to like do counter like surveillance, like electronic surveillance. And that sounds like a totally ridiculous thing, but I mean, just think differently about this stuff, right? If they need electronic systems in order to spy on people, go diving, or go into the shower and write on a whiteboard. Write on a piece of paper. I mean, yeah, talk about fun in your revolution, right? Get in the shower, write on the walls. What could be more fun? And you know you have to take your clothes off and feel up each other's hair to make sure. So, right? But I mean, like in that case, you know, also like a piece of paper that you write on that's sitting next to a fireplace that you instantly burn and you see that it is burned right in front of your eyes and everybody has mutual assurance that that document has been destroyed, that has a lot of value to it, and I really recommend something like that over having a complicated encrypted notepad and all that stuff. So let's see. Okay, so I have, I guess, two quick points which I'll try to do as quickly as possible. So the first is, who here has a laptop? Keep your hands up. Who here has that laptop's hard drive encrypted? Okay. So everybody that has their hand up, try to find someone who has put their hand down and help them to encrypt their hard drive. Because at least for this room of people, there is something pretty, I think, important here, which is that you know, you're carrying around this huge set of documents that has incredible value, not just for you to get through your everyday life, but also in terms of the value it has for intelligence gathering on you. So like anybody that has access to the Occupy Wall Street email blast list, if they have a list of emails on the laptop, that's super valuable. And it is worth, in some cases, people will steal those laptops for that data. But if it's encrypted, it makes it significantly harder for them to steal the data. It's not perfect, but if you have a Mac, you can turn on File Vault, and it's like in the general settings, security, click one button. It's not perfect at all, but it makes their job significantly harder. When I worked at a very large NGO, there was actually a set of laptops on the top floor of a building, and someone broke into the building in the middle of the day, went to the top floor and took just those two laptops, left a stack of cash and all the other computers in the entire organization alone, and then ran out. It was the organization's list of supporters, from what I could tell, right? Encrypting your hard drive makes it so that petty thieves need to now be forensics experts, and maybe they need to get, like, you know, crypto cracking devices. You know, if you have a bad password, you're not going to be safe. But that's like that is a thing that is really worth doing, and it's super easy to do. Putting your stuff inside of a TrueCrypt container on Windows, using DMCrypt, or with Ubuntu, having the actual encrypt my home directory, encrypt my hard drive when you install it, that's very valuable for doing it. You're shaking your head no, but I promise you that it's worth doing.
Not if there's a keylogger on your device, because you get locked out of your own data, because that's happened to me.
Well, yeah, if you have a keylogger, you're fine. But I mean, if the cops shoot you in the face, you're dead, right? But that's totally beside the point, right? If they steal your laptop and it's encrypted, and then they put a keylogger on it, it's like, you know, what's going to happen then, right? It's like you have to defend against separate threats separately, and you have to confine them and compartmentalize those risks to be able to correctly deal with it. And you can't just dismiss the fact that you can't really help the fact that they can replace the firmware in your keyboard or put a keylogger in or, you know, compromise someone who lives close to you or put a camera in your house. But you can do things to try to stop that. You can make sure that when you type in your hard drive password, for example, you put the screen down so a camera above you wouldn't see what you're typing. You can use a YubiKey, which outputs a semi-random stream of data that you've programmed into it, so that a keystroke logger doesn't get that data. I mean, it might actually get that data depending on the keystroke recorder, but there are things that you can do. Like, for example, have a cryptographic key on a USB stick that has nothing to do with the keyboard that you unlock with your passphrase, which if they don't get that and you keep it around your neck, they don't get the data. It's not perfect. None of it's perfect, because these people will break into your computers when they're online. But to that end, it's still worth doing those things, because whether it's economic espionage, whether it's police brutality, different people are willing to go to different extremes. You just want to make it so that they have to go really hard to do it. And if anything, so that they target someone else instead of targeting you. There's an economic incentive to getting the easiest thing in the room. And if you're the easiest thing in the room, you have this transitive risk property where you present a risk to other people. So don't present that risk to other people if you can. I mean, even though you can never make it zero, don't make it 100% and totally obvious. It's not easy. You have to pair up with people in the community to actually encrypt your hard drive properly. And obviously, if you encrypt your hard drive and then you write down every conversation you have with OTR, you defeat the purpose. So you have to have a holistic view of this stuff. But it's still worth doing, and it is not trivial necessarily to do it on some systems, but on a Mac it's like literally point and click simple to do it. And it's worth doing it if you haven't. So on a Mac it's the Apple menu, general settings, security, file vault, encrypt my hard drive. And it'll take a little while to do it. So, you know, plug it into the wall or something. But if you do that, it'll tell you, like, write this code down. This is the key that will unlock your drive. It'll say, would you like to put this on my .Mac account? And you say, no, I don't want to give that to Apple. And you're in great shape if you do that.
And the most recent OS for Mac is full disk.
Yeah, and so in theory, they also have a full disk encryption system. I mean, if you're willing to do that. I think you should ditch proprietary software and go with something like Ubuntu or something like Tails. And just invest a little bit of time in learning, you know? Like, even if you don't have a car, it's still sometimes worthwhile to know how to drive one. Even if you're not a lawyer, it's still a good idea to know your rights. Same deal, right? The last thing I want to do, because this is, I'm just like 3 minutes over here. You guys don't mind, right? Okay, awesome. Okay, so here's the deal, Tor. I totally skipped over all of it. And the reason I skipped over it is because it's the most complicated subject, but it's also the best documented, easiest thing. So the simplest thing is torproject.org. Write that down. We have a bunch of videos. We have a bunch of documentation. All of our specifications, all of our specifications for the protocol are open. One of the guys that created it, Bram Cohen, who also created BitTorrent, is like sitting right there in the audience. That guy is like incredible. Actually, he is actually incredible, not just like incredible. Ask some of the people that worked on it. We're in the community. Talk to you. If you want to understand how it works technically, if you want to understand not how it works technically, but just to actually talk about how you feel like you can practically apply it, you can ask questions about it. But the basic idea of this is that it is a decentralized network to the degree that we think is safe. And it is made up of different people that wish to make it safe. So for example, RiseUp runs a bunch of Tor relays. In the simplest example of how it works, you have three servers out of all of the servers that make up what we call the amorphous Tor network. You pick three of those at random, and you check to see if the choice of the first one, if you can connect to it, and if you can, you pick the second one and you connect to that through the first server. When you do this, you authenticate the first server, and you encrypt your communications to the second server, and you authenticate it as well. It uses the same forward secrecy properties that off-the-record messaging has, so you identify that it is the server you think it is, but with a key that's thrown away at the end of the session. So the first server gives you access to the second. The second server connects to the third, but you choose which server to connect to. And then the third server, you choose to connect out to, say, riseup.net. RiseUp also has what's called a hidden service, which never leaves the Tor network. But in the case of just going to, say, Gmail, because a lot of people here use Gmail, you can use this right now to connect to Gmail, and Gmail will see the IP address of the third server. It will no longer show that you're here in New York City. Wherever the third server is, that's where you will show up. And the key is that the compartmentalization I mentioned before, which is super important to have, you get that. The first server knows that you're somewhere in New York City, and you're someone in New York City, but there's no login and there's no password. The second server knows about the first server, but not that you're in New York. You've just compartmentalized it. The third server has some piece of information about the second server, and it knows that you're going out to somewhere on the internet. So that disconnection of that information means it's not a privacy policy promise that they're not going to disclose your information. This third server doesn't have that information, right? So RiseUp runs some of those servers. I run some of those servers. Tons of people run those servers. And in fact, sometimes it's bad guys, whatever that means. In your parlance, you choose who the bad guys. Some of those bad guys will run those servers. And as long as it's not all of those servers run by the bad guys, the information is compartmentalized in a way where they don't get the information that they would otherwise get. Now, there are exceptions to how this works, but essentially you build these three hops, we call those hops, and then you leave the Tor network. And every 10 minutes you pick another three at random, although the first one often stays the same for a while. And there's a technical reason for that, which is in some peer-reviewed papers, and it's called a guard node. But that aside, you have this network. You just install software on your computer that hooks you up and makes all these choices automatically. You don't have to do any of that at all. Literally none of it. You don't have to do any of it. It just does it automatically. And we have a thing, it's called the Tor browser, which on macOS and Linux on Windows, you download it, it runs Tor, and it's a full web browser based on Firefox that is routed all through Tor. Stuff like Flash doesn't work because Flash is proprietary software that violates your privacy. Sorry. Sucks, but you can usually watch YouTube videos because of HTML5.
I agree.
It depends on which video.
It can't just download it before either.
Well, we can talk about that after the fact. I mean, so we tried to make it easy to use, but like just because we tried doesn't mean we succeed. So Tor browser is available for all these platforms. You can also use, if you have a chat client like Pigeon and OTR, well, so you have that off-the-record messaging property. If you check the SSL, TLS, like encrypt my connection to the chat server box, and then you connect over Tor, you have this really positive property, which is that, you know, now Google, when you log into chat, doesn't know where you're logging in from. So now every time you go online, it's not a dossier of all the places you go. They can still learn when you are on and offline. So there's still some value in watching you and logging that data, but look at that. You just changed that value immensely. And so that's something worth considering. So that, in short, that's what one of the things that Tor does. The network is made up of, as I said, a bunch of volunteers. There are different nodes in the network. Part of the security is from the diversity of the network. So for example, one of the nodes is in New York, one of the nodes is in Amsterdam, another one is in Zimbabwe. How much do you think that the FBI can wiretap you in New York City when you use those three hops to go to a website in Japan? Probably, if they're only watching you locally. This is what happens in Iran, for example. When they censor access, it's because first they surveil you, then they censor you. First they surveil you, then they oppress you. So the same thing is true here. They watch you here with their so-called lawful interception, which that equipment is hacked all the time, right? So, whoops. And I've met people who worked on that equipment that don't believe that that's possible, which is even more funny. But they don't do forensics of their own devices very much, apparently, or they would know that it's true. So, you know, like those are some of those machines for doing so-called lawful intercept. Those devices are like old Sun Solaris machines, which have like known vulnerabilities in them placed on the open internet. So if that can wiretap you, then you're in like a lot of trouble because someone can probably break into it. So if they're wiretapping you, they're watching everything that's happening in this room. They only see your communications with the first server. But if you were, for example, going from here to him over here, well, you go all the way back in. And one of the limits of Tor is if you can see the entrance and the exit, then we believe it is possible and quite reasonable, in fact, for someone to be able to link the sort of in bytes and the out bytes and say, okay, this was sent here and then received here. They're probably talking to each other. So it's not perfect by any means. But if you're worried about data retention telling a story about you, I'd rather it said that I use the Tor network all the time than it gave up my exact location. And so even though it's not perfect, it's pretty good for that kind of threat. But if you were, for example, one of the guys that was recently arrested in Chicago, my understanding is that the FBI was watching both ends of the conversation by having a guy who ratted him out say, is he online or offline, and then going around and pulling suspects' internet connections and knocking them offline and seeing if they fell offline in their anonymous channel. So that's what we would call a traffic confirmation attack. It's a very basic one, and it is, you know, it's a problem, right, in the anonymity world. I mean, I think a lot of people want to condemn that guy for whatever it is that he's alleged to have done without speaking to that. It's a problem in the sense that anonymity systems have vulnerabilities. I'd like them to be perfect. They're really hard to do that. The Mixmaster system is what's called a high latency anonymity network. So Tor is a low latency. So you send it in and it comes out as quickly as possible. And the trade-off is that you can do stuff like browse the web and you can chat with people and you can have a voice over IP call. Whereas with Mixmaster, you put a message in, like an email message in, and maybe it doesn't come out for 2 weeks. So that kind of traffic correlation is like actually really difficult to do. And in fact, some of the best anonymity people in the world think that it is almost impossible to do. I don't have like a lot of confidence in anything, but I think that that is a reasonable assertion. So if you wanted to send a message and you wanted to have really good anonymity, probably what I would do is compose Mixmaster and Tor, and that I would use Tor so no one knew if they were watching my local internet connection that I was using Mixmaster, because since so few people use it, if someone I know receives a Mixmaster message or the NYPD received a Mixmaster message or something like that, it would be pretty obvious just from wiretapping people who was probably worth targeting. But if 50,000 people are using Tor and then they use that to connect to Mixmaster, that changes the whole dynamic a bit. And so I had a long-standing discussion with one of the early Remailer guys about this who sadly passed away, really incredible guy by the name of Len Sassman, who really believed that people should actually run this stuff, not just design it. One of the sort of questions is that really worth doing, or is it better to have a Gmail account you only use once and throw away? I don't know which one is better, so you have to choose. I think the answer is to use Tor and Mixmaster together. I think that's the reasonable thing to do. It's up for debate. Once we start to get into this kind of esoteric stuff, we don't, you know, there are theories and there are peer-reviewed journals and there are whole communities to talk about this stuff. But the basic idea is that you're making it significantly harder. So for example, in Germany, the German police like to attack people by taking over their DSL line. Sorry, German police. Not really. But basically, they take over the DSL line and then they like tell the computer that it has an update. Maybe like to like some piece of software that is an add-on. There's another piece of software called EvilGrade that pretends to offer upgrades to people's software. And so basically, the police have a commercial version of this. Finfisher makes something like this. And basically, they pretend that there's an upgrade. And so you say, yep, I want to stay secure, install this upgrade. And the funny statistic that I heard is that all the guys in the right-wing parties always install the updates and like click on the, yeah, update that, install my Flash player or whatever. And like all the Antifa left-wing guys all use Tor. And so they don't get fished by the government that is targeting them that way. Like, I'm sure they get like compromised in other ways. Everybody gets compromised somehow if you're targeted enough. But it's fascinating because that means that practically one of these ways of operating is just not safe and secure, and human nature allows someone to fall over. And, you know, the other side of that is that it is possible to build a system where they have to resort to other measures. So probably tactical exploitation, like send them a Microsoft doc, and when it opens it, it crashes it and takes control of their computer. So there are limits to this stuff, but if you really go in deep with it and you're using something like Tails, the bootable operating system, there's no configuration. It's a totally alien world because you're using something like Debian, which if you've never heard of that before, it's kind of a shock to your system. That offers a lot of these protections automatically with no configuration. And so you just have to choose your own level of involvement, and then you have this. And a really big part of it, I think, is to just ditch the chains of proprietary software and to learn about the systems you interact with, whether they're political, social, or in this case, the mixture of the two in the software world. So I think I have exactly enough time before I have to run to take some questions. Anybody has a couple of questions?
I went to the library to download Tor. I didn't want to do it at home. And I logged into Facebook, tried to log into Facebook via Tor, and it blocked me. It said, wait, this isn't you.
Yeah.
You know? So I left it and went to another browser and tried to log in there, and it said, hey, someone's trying to access.
Yeah.
Was that you? Mm-hmm. And I got an email from Facebook that says, hey, you were somewhere else. So that kind of speaks to a decent amount of traffic.
Yeah, so it's a traffic analysis, which they try to sell to you as a feature. And in that case, it is a positive feature. So you prove who you say you are, but you still don't disclose your location. Like some of the Facebook guys used to really hate Tor, and then Iran blocked Tor, or Iran blocked Facebook, and then Facebook users all started using proxies and using Tor, and they were like, well, actually, maybe Tor is not just for jerks. And they rethought it, right? Sometimes people don't understand their position of privilege in the world, and so when they have their worldview readjusted, it's nice when it's readjusted that way. Unfortunately, there are still a lot of jerks, but jerks have lots of options, and regular people don't have very many, certainly not sustainable ones. So like companies that sell you anonymity products, you have to be really skeptical of that. And companies that do track you, like Facebook, they will try to take some of that tracking and sell it to you, and it's worth considering the value of it, but remember what the rest of the costs are.
So, two questions, no screening, please.
Okay, you want me to turn it off?
I don't care about sound. Is there an option in Tor to limit the exit to a particular country? So
yes.
Google doesn't give you an account in Czechoslovakia?
Yes, you can change that. But if you do that, you change your behavior and you no longer behave like all other Tor users, which means that your behavior is different, which means you stand out from the crowd. And there's a saying, anonymity loves company. So if you change the way that you stand out from the crowd, you're not as anonymous as you were before. It's not clear what that means. Maybe it's fine to create a Google account in Czechoslovakia. In fact, maybe it's preferable. Maybe the privacy laws in Germany are better than the privacy laws here. Just consider.
It stands out in different ways, because it actually talks to the problem he was talking about, is Facebook thinks he's in another country, and therefore, rather than...
That's fine. Poisoning data sets is extremely valuable. I mean, you get to make that choice.
But that stands out.
It only stands out from their analytic sense, but it doesn't stand out in the someone is watching your network connection sense. Because you behave like all other Tor users. You have to choose that. If you want to reconfigure it to go from the US, fine. But lots of Americans sign up from Facebook, I'm sure, from Czechoslovakia for the first time. I mean, if you're using Facebook anyway, it's like...
Yeah.
I mean...
Second question, is there a SDK for using embedding it in an iPhone app?
There's a guy that just wrote a Tor browser for iPhone, and basically he did that somehow, and I think it's free software, so you can look at it. We don't have an SDK in that sense. We're free software, so just make sure that you are free software too, in accordance with our license, which is BSD. So in theory, you can make it proprietary software incorporating it, but I mean, that's just mean. But you could do it if you wanted to, because the license allows it. So just look at how that guy did it, comply with the same license, and you should be good to go. But you know, there's a limit to that. Also, it's like if every app, the iPhone model really sucks. So if every app includes a copy of Tor and then starts Tor, and 10 apps are running, you have this like really big problem, which is you have like 10 Tor clients loading the Tor network. So it's very impolite to do that. On Android, we have the solution, which is that you install Orbot, and now Orbot runs, and all applications can integrate with it, and that works and scales very well. So I mean, that's the, I think, the right thing to do. You have a question?
Yeah. So thank you for this security update. So those of us who have been above ground, vocal, visible activists most of our adult lives, and anonymity is not an option, I feel like, from what you're saying. Well, I'm not even a techie. I'm just a content producer. You know, I organized the New York City Anarchist Film Festival in honor of Brad Will, our comrade who was murdered in Oaxaca, Mexico, while he was wearing his indie media shirt and filming. But my point is, just that there's nowhere to hide. You're so above ground. You're talking about changing your behaviors, and I really like that you're you said before you might be paranoid, but you're actually being vigilant, because whereas paranoia is driven by fear, you're sort of being driven by awareness and humor. And so, what would you suggest to these very visible above ground activists? Really, just have their voice and are trying to use it to mobilize and inspire and galvanize resistance movements, but here we are facing this counterinsurgency from the state, and you're recommending this counterinsurgency, counter surveillance.
No, I'm recommending just building. I'm recommending not counter reactionary stuff. I'm suggesting building alternatives. So I suggest to people that are above ground, underground, whatever, the same thing, which is participate in an anonymity network, participate in creating this alternative. There's a lot of value in doing that, because anonymity has different kinds of anonymity. So for example, you might say that you're above ground and you have like nothing to worry about.
I'm experiencing a lot of these problems. We're talking about like DSL lines being taken over and like our communications being intercepted, and it's so like overwhelming.
Right, so the thing is that just because you have some activity which is obviously known, it doesn't mean you want to disclose it to everyone, right? So you might not care that the police know you're going to a protest, but you might not be happy with the Zetas knowing you're going to the ATM, right? You still need to compartmentalize your risk and deal with it in that way. Like, you're a woman, maybe you don't want to walk alone at night in some parts of town, and I'm a man, I don't want to walk alone in a different part of town, right? And people that have different gender identities have different values for that, and different people do, right? So regardless of that, you get location anonymity in addition to identity anonymity. And there's different values that you have to decide. I care a lot about location privacy. So I use Twitter, for example. I don't want the places that I use Twitter from to be wiretapped, so I use Tor or other computer systems and Tor composed together so that whatever Twitter can give up is not useful for tracking me. That's not because my real name isn't on my Twitter account. It's because I want to make the metadata about me worthless. And it's totally valuable to do that, even if you're like the most popular activist in the whole world. And in fact, if that is the case, you should be doing that. You should be running Tor relays. You should be running Mixmaster nodes. You should be standing up vocally for the rights of people to be anonymous online. Because if not you, who, and if not now, when, applies just the same for anonymity services. And that, I think, helps to build an alternative for people that are not as vocal, that aren't willing to speak out without anonymity, right? Anonymity is a necessity for people that don't have the privilege of speaking out with their real name attached to it. So there's real value in that. If nothing else, helping to build the alternative infrastructure that protects people instead of exploiting them. And I think that's probably like the key thing that we're trying to do with the Tor project, is to build alternatives that are sustainable, that have the right incentives, so that all of us can have anonymity. Because if all of us don't have anonymity, none of us have anonymity. And without anonymity, we can't really have privacy. We can't really have security, right? Without anonymity, it's difficult to not be targeted, for example, because you can be denied a security update. So they don't have to find a bug, they just wait for someone else to find a bug, and then they break into your computer. And there are weaponized toolkits that do this kind of stuff. There's an entire arms industry, if you want to use that analogy. So even in that position, people still have a responsibility, I think, socially. Yeah.
I just wanted to know whether or not you feel that keystroke encryptions are valueless nowadays. Keystroke, like Sensory Bay's software.
Say it again?
Keystroke encryptors, are they valueless nowadays? Something like Sensory Bay's software encrypts every stripe of the key, every keyboard stripe.
Sounds like what I would call snake oil crypto, which is like you type in a thing and someone is intercepting from the keyboard to the computer. Whatever happens inside the yeah. So if the keystroke recorder is plugged in between your keyboard and your computer, the unencrypted data is captured by the police, the thieves, the whoever, before it ever gets to your browser. So I think that kind of stuff. It's like that, like, you know, spyware finder type stuff. It's just like you'll never find a government backdoor with that stuff. And if you do, it's like dumb luck, and you won't know it's a government backdoor. No, I mean, a virtual private network is something separate. RiseUp offers a virtual private network. I think that there are times when that's useful. I recommend if you're going to use a VPN, that then you use Tor on top of it. So you start the VPN, you connect to a place, and then you use, say, the Tor browser. And what happens is the VPN sees you're using Tor. Local network doesn't even see you're using Tor. I mean, it has basically the same properties, but it does mean that you have a slightly different set of security trade-offs. And I think a VPN has some value, but it also has this problem of centralizing your data. And usually, it's a single hop. So that means that they know who you are, they know where you're coming from, they know where you're going to, and what you're saying.
Well, so, the holistic VPN is definitely peer-to-peer.
What is?
The holistic VPN is peer-to-peer.
I don't know.
The original VPN concept is peer-to-peer.
Well, yeah, it is, but it doesn't change the fact that if you send all your traffic to the first peer... Yeah, I mean, that's a huge problem. Yeah, so Tor is actually peer-to-peer in that sense. So you can use a not peer-to-peer VPN combined with Tor, and you get some special security properties out of it. It's probably worth doing it in that if you are what's called leaking, that is, you're trying to do stuff and you think you're doing it over Tor, like you start Tor and then you fire up Skype, like you're not gonna actually Torify your Skype connection, right? If you have a VPN, it'll shunt all that traffic somewhere else. There is value in that. And in fact, I use a couple VPNs in what we would call a chain, so that if my computer were to ever leak, the local network still doesn't see what's going on. So even if like someone broke out of Tor, figured a way to like get my browser to crash or something like that, at least someone wiretapping me here would have, like, I just want to make it as hard as possible for them, whoever they might be, right? I mean, it might be a kid with fire sheep at like a Starbucks, you know, it might be like someone that's doing intercepts on the DSL line when I'm in this building, so. Yeah?
My information may be a year or two old, but I think it's a felony to lie to an FBI agent.
Yeah, don't talk to them. Talk to a lawyer. Yeah. Is that your question?
No, that's just a comment.
Yeah, I mean, don't lie. I mean, don't talk to the police, any police or anybody like that. It's just, it's like inviting vampires into your home. Bad idea. Don't do it. Anybody, any last questions before we get kicked out of here?
Is this talk going to be online someplace?
Yes.
Probably. I hope I don't regret it. So I hope you guys all go and enable yourself. So.